So this talk is about this framework called Escher.jl. And the .jl part means that it's a Julia package. So this is a convention called Julia packages used for easy discoverability on Google, basically. So what Escher is a framework for writing web apps entirely in Julia, okay? In this talk, I'm going to basically motivate why we need such a thing. Why do we need to write everything in one language? Why does it have to be this way? And how does it help certain kinds of people write UIs? And I'm also going to basically get into the construction of such a package, construction of a share. Okay. So to start off motivating why we need this thing, I'm going to talk a little bit about functional programming. Right. So it's surprising how many people that actually practice functional programming do not cannot define functional programming, right? So people think it's like higher order functions, functions as values, and like various type systems. And people say that if you do not have a statically typed Hindley-Milner type system, you don't have a functional language. But at the most basic level, functional programming is just programming with stateless functions, right? You program with functions which give you the same output for the same inputs, no matter where they're executed or how they're executed, right? So that's the basic fundamental building block of functional programming. But this has a problem. So if you just have functions which take some value and give back the same value for the same inputs, how are you going to change the world? Like, how are you going to do some modifications that are required for actual effects to happen in the world, right, from your program? So one such side effect is UI design, because to show anything on a screen, you're basically doing some kind of side effect. And the most dominant way of writing UIs today is using the web, right? So the web has this API called DOM, Document Object Model, which is this convention where you use this object called document, which is a huge mutable data structure. The way you write programs is to manipulate this thing is you go and mutate certain parts of the DOM so that you can see the changes reflect in your UI. This is inherently a stateful abstraction, and it's not very it doesn't go well with functional programming because it easily breaks down. So there's this new idea called virtual DOM, popularized by this Facebook's React framework. So what virtual DOM does is libraries using virtual DOM do is that they represent the DOM as an immutable data structure. And then whenever there needs to be a change to the DOM, they just generate a new value which represents the DOM. And then you diff the two representations and figure out what exactly changed. And then you go modify only those parts in the actual DOM. So this makes for an efficient pipeline. So you have functions which keep generating new UIs for every update in the app, and then virtual DOM libraries handle efficiently patching this. So firstly, virtual DOM enables this kind of functional expression of UIs, where you take some data and then give back a value which represents the UI. So this has the benefit that all the benefits that come with functional programming, right? So you don't have to think about what state some other guy has created in your app is going to affect your code, or how it's going to affect, or how whatever you're doing, some mutation to the DOM is going to affect someone else's code and stuff like that. That is one thing. And the other thing is you are only thinking about, at any program point, you're only thinking about the arguments to that function, right, which you're writing. So it actually fits in your head. You can think about your large applications as smaller parts, which are composed nicely. And then the DOM reconciliation, which is the trick where you diff and update the DOM, that gives you efficiency for free, right? And it also like sidesteps a lot of resource leak problems, which are common to easily, which you can get into easily when you're writing JavaScript, right? So it also gets along well with the paradigm functionally reactive programming. We'll see about that like soon. So this is virtual DOM is a substrate for functional programming in GUIs, right? In web GUIs at least. So there is this package called patchwork.jl, which uses this package called functional collections.jl. So what functional collections provides is immutable data structures, basically, like closure does. So there are immutable maps, immutable vectors, which Patchwork uses to represent DOM trees. Okay, and Patchwork also uses this library called Virtual DOM, which is a JavaScript library, to basically take Julia Virtual DOM values, serialize them to. I mean, you can send a Julia Virtual DOM value serialized as JSON to the browser. And the browser will use this library to actually draw the DOM, right? So, and also it handles the diff patching and stuff. So how does it look? So this is very simple Julia code. This is a constructor called, for a type called LM. I'm just creating an LM which is a div, and I'm putting hello world in it, and adding some style to it, okay? So these are actually DOM properties. That's how they manifest in the browser. So I can say I want to increase the padding over here. So I have this REPL where I write some code and hit Control Enter and the thing updates on the right. So I can it's basically you're creating the DOM in Julia, and then Escher can draw it in the browser. So that's the simplest model. And then it also extends to SVG. Not very surprising. So you can already start making these small abstractions for building things, right? So I made a function called mkCircle. So this is a function definition in Julia. These are the list of arguments, and this is the expression that gets evaluated. So this function basically returns a circle with these parameters. Okay, so I'm using that to create an SVG element with a bunch of circles which give me that picture on the right side. Let me make this a little. So I can edit this and it all works. So one more thing we can get from virtual DOM. This is like very important insight. Is that we do not actually just represent these simple DOM elements, right? We can have our own elements which have custom behavior, which have custom JavaScript inbuilt to do something. So, for example, this is a LaTeX element that I'm using. I can change this here and. Okay, so this is a LaTeX element I'm using. I'm creating a custom element called Kartek, which is loaded over here. It's just a bunch of HTML, which creates this thing called a custom element. It's a new spec, part of the web component specifications. So here I have an attribute in that element called source, which is like the LaTeX version of what needs to be drawn. And then it's going to go render this thing. So, but if you inspect this and see, this is like a bunch of spans with custom stylings in themselves. So we didn't actually generate this stuff in Julia. This was actually generated as a single tag, which got rendered into this in the browser through the web components web components being there. So similarly, I have this code mirror component, which will just give me a code editor. So that's what I'm using right here on the left side. Okay, so this is a very simple substrate, right? The LM type. It works by generating DOM. But can we do better? Like, if you can we abstract other things that a UI programmer needs? Yeah. Substrate is like the most basic building block for building a UI library. Sure. Yeah. So yeah, there is some polymer code as well, like that I've written. But it's as you can you'll see later that like they're all reusable parts, so you can just combine them in Julia itself and not bother with. This slideshow is also made with Escher, so like all nested. So we need some, can we create other layers of abstractions on top of virtual DOM for making the life of a UI programmer very simple, okay? So the users of Julia are not usually UI programmers. They're like scientists and people doing data science and things like that, who use Julia for the speed and expressiveness when it comes to mathematical kind of computing. I think it's also very expressive when it comes to general purpose computing. So we want them to not spend time learning HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Can we do better? Like, it seems like there should be a nice, very compact abstraction to build everything on top of, right? So what Escher does is it provides these bunch of abstractions over this virtual DOM, so that this becomes easy. So the abstraction one is converting plain Julia values to UI, right? UI being virtual DOM. So there's this function called convert in Julia, which is this which has a ton of methods, right? It has a method for converting each kind of conversion you want to define in the language. Like if you want to define a conversion from a floating point to an integer, there's a convert method. I can just show you like this thing in the REPL. So this is the Julia prompt. I can say convert, and it'll tell me it's a generic function with 529 methods in whatever Julia I'm using right now, right? So I can also see what are the methods of convert. So as you can see, it has these methods, for example. So this one, for example, is a method to convert a big int to an integer. So you can actually, yeah, so there it is. Like, that's the definition of the convert method. So you can dig into whatever you want in Julia this way, right? So so that's the convert method. So what we can do is, so Escher deals with this type called tile. It knows how to convert a tile to an LM. So what we can do is we can define convert methods to convert any type to a tile, right? I mean, you can think of this as an LM itself. So that would be some kind of function to generate the UI for my type. All right. So this is straightforward. Like, this is just a string. And what happens is the string gets put in a, the convert function for a string will just return an LM with a span, and the string goes inside the span. Okay. So if you inspect this, you'll see that it's a span with some hello world text inside. So you can also write Markdown. So there's this package called, there's this module called Markdown. So I can say make this bold. Italic. All that works. And I can have multi-line strings with more Markdown. Okay. Also, I can put some Julia code inside. Code gets inlined. I can put some LaTeX if you want to. So that's like custom syntax for LaTeX. Okay. This works when I. So. Okay. I'll just remove that LaTeX for now. Yeah, it works in the next thing I'm going to show. So this is kind of ugly though. Like you say Markdown dot parse and then pass it a Markdown string and it creates a Markdown tree. So if you look at the type of this, it's actually something called MD, and Escher basically has some convert methods for MD to convert it to type. That's how this is working. This is kind of ugly to write this. So Julia has this thing called string macros. You can simply make a Markdown string, which is going to do the same thing. Right? Now I think this thing works. Yeah, there you go. So the LaTeX got inlined over there. So that's LaTeX. I could have written like other crazy things. Another thing is this thing called, another thing is vector graphics. Julia has this library called compose.jl, written by Daniel Jones, which is a very nice vector graphic library. So it has backends to SVG, PNG, and PDF, and PGF formats. All I had to do was write a backend for the patchwork LM type, right? So what it does is it just generates the SVG under the hood. The equivalent virtual DOM for the SVG. So this is the Sierpinski's triangle thing. So since we are in a general purpose programming language, which is also functional, we can do all these, we can use the power of a Turing machine and then use recursion and do this thing. So what this is actually doing, Sierpinski's triangle is a recursive construction where in each, a Sierpinski's triangle of n steps is a triangle where the three sub-triangles are a Sierpinski's triangle of n minus one steps, right? So that's exactly what this is describing over here. And so the context, the three different contexts you see, telling where to draw the next Sierpinski's triangle. And the T over here is just Sierpinski n minus one. And when n is zero, you just draw a simple triangle. Right? So if I pass zero to this thing, it's going to just draw me a triangle. One will do this, two will do this, three will do this, and six will do that. So, if you have any questions, you can ask me, interrupt. So this is plotting. How do you do plotting? I wanted to show one more thing about the Markdown stuff, right? So you can actually interpolate any other UI that you make. Let's just make a tech for now, but it could be any other Escher UI with interactivity embedded, it doesn't matter. So I'm just making this thing called a variable called X, which is a LaTeX version of A plus B. And then I can actually just put that inside the Markdown string, and it gets interpolated right inside. So I have this cool notebook. Cool, whatever. So it's like a literate programming summary of this paper called Functional Geometry by Peter Henderson. So it reconstructs this this woodcut by M.C. Escher called square limit. So it's again a recursive construction where you have this one primitive called a fish, and you have a bunch of operators on it. So I'm just going to show it. So a picture is just the denotation of what needs to be drawn, and then you have these operators on the picture, which are very simple, like rot will rotate it 90 degrees, flip will flip it, above and beside will juxtapose two pictures. I'm going to go, you can just see these things. So this is the code that generates this. So you can do things like this with Escher. I'll just show you the code for making this. Show you the notebook once and then switch to the code. So this is the final thing where we're using all those functions we built so far to make this final image from a single fish, right? So if I go to the code over here, so you see that it's a giant Markdown string with all this other stuff interpolated in between, right? So this is an Escher UI which came and got plugged inside this in the right place in the Markdown. So as you can see, the whole UI is just a 300 line Markdown string. I think that's really useful for writing reports and doing things when you are in the flow and you don't have to bother with JavaScript and stuff. So there's one more thing I skipped, which is this thing called SymPy. It's a symbolic manipulation package written in Python, but we can call it from Julia. So there's a thin wrapper around this stuff called SymPy, which I'm using here. And I'm creating a variable called x. I mean, it's just an expression called which represents x. I can say x squared, and then that returns an expression which is x squared now. Now I have a convert method to convert SymPy expressions into Escher tiles, right? So that's what is happening there. And then there is, SymPy has these symbolic differentiation functions, has this function, which is like, which takes a function, which takes an expression, and then the variable to derive it using, and then the 5 over there is the fifth derivative. Okay, so it's computing the fifth derivative of sine x squared. Yeah. So second derivative, third. So you can play with this, and this works. Any sort of expression actually works. You can make this like y. On. Yeah, so I'll just skip to the plot thing again. So there is a package called gadfly, which uses compose to plot things, right? So there is this this idea called grammar of graphics, and there is a nice implementation in R called ggplot2, and gadfly is another implementation of grammar of graphics. It's basically a principled set of primitives to make any kind of plots that you want, right? So this is a simple plot where I'm plotting the sine and cos functions from 0 to 25, and this is the output I'm getting. So gadfly also returns basically immutable values, so it's easy to convert them to, again, Escher UIs. So I didn't have to do any extra work to do this, right? Like, I wrote a backend for compose, but it started working with gadfly, because gadfly uses so there's another cooler plot which takes a while to draw, but it's worth it. Yeah, so that's a contour plot. It's basically drawing the heat map of some function 2D plane. So another set of abstractions is layouts. Layouts with CSS is like a pain. So we went and thought about what can we do about it? Like, how can it be any better? Right? So what we ended up doing, was borrow some ideas from LaTeX and then use that and some of the abstractions given by Flexbox Layouts, which is a new CSS spec, I mean, it's not very new. Oh, there is a square here. You can't see it. So it's very blue. Anyway, I can change the color. So what I'm doing here is I'm creating a container of 10 EM into 10 EM size, another container of 5 EM into 5 EM size, and I'm generating some bunch of colors that I want to use later on, right? So, and these bunch of colors are generated by this package called colors. I think Julia's colors package is the most extensive colors package there is. Like, some of colorimetry people really love it. So they contributed a lot, and it's like really good. So there is this primitive called vbox. What it does is it, oh, by the way, this notation I hope everyone understands. It's like, so this is equivalent to, so just syntactic sugar. Like, if for fill color, I leave out the second argument, it's going to return a new lambda, which takes the second argument and fills the color, right? So I can have this nice chaining of expressions where I take something and put it into another thing that changes its style. So by the way, all these things are returning immutable values. So you can go back to any previous form of it and then modify it and to create new ones, right? So since I'm in a language as powerful as Julia, I can use some, like, say, list comprehension. I'm just going to create, I'll just skip that and come back to this. So you can do this list comprehension. I have a version in the next slide. So if you wanted to give two, if you wanted to give some spacing between two elements, in CSS, you would have to figure out which thing to pad or give a margin to and which thing to not give a margin to. And then all that kind of bureaucracy. But LaTeX has this thing called vskip and hskip, which is like empty spaces in the vertical and horizontal direction, right? So I can do that here. Similarly, it works if you just change all the v's to h. It'll just make it horizontal. So it's a hbox is something that puts all of its arguments in the horizontal. So I can have a bunch of these, and they all go in the horizontal direction. So sometimes you also want to like expand some of these things to fill the remaining space. So you can use this thing called flex. If you use flex without any arguments, like over here, it's going to put an empty space to fill the extremes. Yeah. I mean, yeah, it goes right inside the elements inline. But it's a consistent abstraction, right? You're calling functions with new your UIs, and they're returning back UIs. Right, so it depends on what they're exporting. Yeah, it's part of colors. You can do that, it will work too. All packages can decide what they want to export. So that's what you get in this namespace when you do using colors. So there's a statement called export XYZ. So it'll export XYZ. And this is how you Anyway, okay, let's just deal with a list of box one, box two, box three. I think this is good enough for now. I think it's some bug with my evaluator. I'm just going to call that list X. I can say V box X, and that should work. So say I wanted to intersperse some space between all these boxes. Again, in CSS, you have more decisions to do than necessary. Like you have to decide where to put the margin, and then you have to go to the last element and remove the margin because you don't want that empty space there. So, since you're writing in a functional way, you can do this thing called intersperse, which has nothing to do with Escher at all. So I want 1 em space, let's say, between all the elements of X. So what I'm doing here is interspersing V box 1 em between each element in X. So that shouldn't have happened. Not V box. Sorry. It's just showing the length type. Thanks. So I can increase that and decrease that and stuff. Put it in a H box. It should work, but it might get compressed. There are ways to leverage flexbox primitives. So if you want everything to be centered, you can do this. Axis start. This is the default behavior. And like this. Same thing works for H boxes. You can also something called space around. These are all there in the flex box. So that's text layouts, textile layouts, or whatever style layouts you want to call it. But it's not similar to slightly not similar to CSS, right? So how do you give padding and like place things inside each other? So that's another thing that you need to deal with when you're making layouts, right? So so there's a pad function which will apply arbitrary amounts of padding to any Escher UI, right? Okay, so that's giving this box a 3M padding. So I can use X now inside another thing where I, maybe. Yeah, that's the padding function. And then you can inset a box inside another box by doing this. Right, so this was my X. What I'm doing here is I'm creating a container of 10EM into 10EM, which is filled with the orange color. And then I'm putting the X in the middle of that. So if I removed all this padding, it should go. Oh yeah, so it's actually also offsetting. Oh, you can't see the blue color. That's well. Okay, that's actually like pink here. Okay, now you can see. So what I'm doing here is offsetting. So I'm placing X. This is the third argument. I'm placing X inside the second argument, which is the container, and I'm placing it at this offset. And I can start an offset from any point, any corner, right? Like I could say top left. Both have the same size, so yeah, there you go. Offset from the top right corner, go -3EM in this direction, -3.4EM in that direction. So all that works. So you can choose any corner as the reference and then move your thing that you're offsetting. This is kind of hard to do in CSS. This is a code that I, like look at when I'm writing CSS. To feel superior. So it's a code by Brett Victor, who writes essays and does demos about UI programming. So it's about CSS, right? CSS is so complex that it's never been implemented correctly. Yet successive versions specify even more complexity. At the same time, it is so underpowered that many elementary graphic designs are impossible or prohibitively difficult, right? And most CSS lore is dedicated to describing the tangles of brittle hacks needed to circumvent incompatibilities or approximate a design. But I think we can do better by like just abstracting it, abstracting the whole the DOM, right? And I think Escher tries to do some of that. One cause of CSS mess is eschewing of elegant, flexible abstractions for 1,000 special cases. And it's also because the language tries to be a tool and a platform. But we can use it as a platform and build a set of principled library functions on top of it. So there is this thing called higher order layouts. So just HBox and VBox won't cut it most of the time. So you need things like tabs, for example, simple example. So here I have two tabs, which have vector graphics and plots as their labels. And I can create these two pages. And then I have this function called wire, which takes two elements. And then this is the name for the wire. And then it connects this attribute between them, right? So notice that this is actually returning a new T, P, right? It's returning a new set of tabs and pages. So now I can use this new tabs and pages in my layout, and they'll still be connected. But this is entirely functional, right? Like you're not mutating anything. You're not setting things to X, Y, Z. So another abstraction is the typography. Nothing crazy about this. It's just like a type scale. So I have this thing called title, which goes from 1 to 4, and it increases like this exponentially. And then this thing called heading, which is actually not so good. Anyway, so here is an example of how you can create UIs in a list comprehension, for example. They're just like any other Julia value, so you can do anything that you do with any other value in Julia, right? So this is a list comprehension which is generating 4 titles and 4 headings, and then concatenating them. Vcat is actually a Julia function which concatenates 2 vectors vertically. And then I put them in a Vbox, and you get a vertical layout of all the 8 things. Okay, cool. So far we saw that we can use this kind of abstraction to write UIs as if they were functions which take pure functions which take data to UI, data line to UI line, right? What we actually want to do is when the data updates, we want to update the UI, right? So so it's possible to create an abstraction where your F remains a pure function, and then you represent changing data as some data type, as you will see next. So that is essentially like what reactive programming tries to do. So for interaction, we turn to reactive programming. So there's this package called Reactive.jl, which is inspired by this programming language called Elm. I think some of you might have heard of it. Bogmi was here. He spoke about Elm recently. And yeah, so it's it has this thing called signals, a library called signals, which is basically a data type for representing time varying values, right? So what we want to essentially do is take some time varying data. The subscript T represents like varying over time, and then pass it through a function to get a time varying output, right? So we'll look at what a signal is. It's like a crash course to reactive programming. So a signal is basically two things. It has a value at any given time. This is like the axioms that a signal always holds, right? It has a value at any given time, first thing. And secondly, the value held by a signal can change as time passes. Very simple rules. And how you create an input signal is using this constructor called input. You give it a initial value, because a signal always needs to have a value. Then to update the value it contains, you say this push bang, you use this push bang function to push, say, 42 onto this int signal, right? So that updates the signal. We can see some of this in the REPL. Let's call this 0, right? So push x 42. Actually does that and returns nothing, but when you look at x, it's 42 now. So there's this other operator called consume, which can consume, let's say I want to add 1 to each update to x, right? So this is going to return me a new signal y, which is now always 1 more than x, right? So if I push to x now, let's say 4, y should be 5. Okay. So you can build this kind of graph of dependencies, if you will, right? So there are other operators, which I'll show you now. So one of them is consume that I just showed. Like it takes a function and a signal, and returns a signal which is like a map over the previous signal with that function, right? So another thing is foldL. I'm just going to show it here. Let's create a counting example. FoldL. What it does is it takes an accumulated value and a new value, and then returns 1 plus accumulated value. That's a lambda in Julia. It's very simple. Like, take a bunch of arguments, that's the expression. And I start off with this foldL with the value 0, and then I'm folding over x, right? So if I look at cnt, it's 0 right now. It's basically going to count how many updates I make to x from now on, right? So I have 5 updates, so if I check cnt, it should be 5. So foldL allows you to keep some state and then keep updating something. That's the second primitive over there on signals. And then there is filter, which will take a function and then a signal. And whenever the function holds, like it's a Boolean function, it returns a Boolean, it's going to keep the values in the signal. Right? So, okay. And there's merge, which can merge multiple signals together, and drop repeats, which will drop any repeats to the input signal. And then keep when takes a switch signal and another signal and like switches off the second signal when the switch signal is on, is off. Similarly, there's drop when, and there's FPS. FPS is actually a special case here. It doesn't take any signal as input. It takes a floating point value and returns a signal which updates that many number of times a second. Right? If you say FPS 30, it's going to return a signal which is going to try to update 30 times a second. But the thing is, FPS is like a maximum estimate, right? Your system may not be able to handle that many updates every second. So in that case, FPS is automatically going to throttle the updates and get you the maximum possible FPS below that FPS. So here's how you implement interactivity, right? So you create an input signal, and then I'll just show you what the slider thing does. So by the way, whatever I'm executing here, the last thing I execute will be shown on the right side. So I'm just showing the slider now. The slider goes from 1 to 6. That's a range object in Julia. The colon expression is a range object. So slider takes a range object, it creates a slider. And then how you can get updates from a slider is using this thing called subscribe. Right? So what subscribe does is it takes a widget. Actually, a widget is a more general thing, which I'll get to in the next slide. And then a signal. And then it annotates that widget to denote that this widget talks to this signal on the server, right? Whenever I update, I need to go tell the server that I want to update the steps input over there, right? So I have that, and then I can put it in a VBox. Now the slider is connected to the input, and then I'm consuming the input and creating CRP speed triangles, right? So if I execute this, I get this. I think something went wrong. Like, there is a edge case in the evaluator if there's like a compile time error, it's going to break interactivity. Anyway, so I'll come back here. Yeah. Just to show that this actually works. Okay. Okay, yeah, so that's how it works. Like, So it's pretty clear by looking at the code that over here I'm using the step signal to make this. And the slider is talking to the steps. Here's an example of how you can do an animation. I'm using a FPS when here. And switch state is actually this toggle button over here. And I'm creating a signal that updates 60 FPS at 60 FPS when the switch state is true, right? So, and finally, my UI is just like put the switch there and then consume the snowball with a tick signal. Right? I consume and apply snowball, show ball function with, to the tick signal. So you'd think there'll be some kind of JavaScript which handles, that Julia code is generating, which like goes and sits on top of these widgets and handles all the events. But that would break so this nice property of just generating virtual DOMs, right? So what we can do is we can create custom HTML elements which do these nice little things to make a widget, right, basically. So we call these things behavior. A behavior is something that goes and attaches itself to another UI and returns a new UI again. And it adds some special property to it, which can result in a signal. For example, here's a clickable behavior. I'm taking some arbitrary tile over here, arbitrary Escher UI, which is this thing called click me, which has that font size and some font weight. And then I'm applying the clickable behavior to it. So now I get a button which has this behavior. Now I can subscribe to any behavior as well, just like I was doing with the slider widget. So what I'm doing here is subscribing the click signal, which starts off, which actually updates to the mouse button I clicked. And it starts off with a left button to maintain that property that all signals need to have a value at any time. So when I click on this, it's going to go tell the click signal that I got a click. And then below that, I have this folder, which is basically counting the thing that I showed you in the reference. So it's counting the number of clicks I make here. So this is kind of composable. So if I inspect the element over here, what it's actually doing is it's putting a span over here, and then there's a clickable behavior thing, it's this crazy magic thing, which goes inside the span, and then adds an event listener to clicks on that span. And it's also configurable, right? You can tell what buttons you want to listen to, and stuff like that. And it's also going to add a signal transport. This is what the subscribe function does. It returns the same thing with a signal transport, which has some metadata, which raises events to send back values to the server. So that's how the clicks go back to the server. But we are still generating just plain JSON, which makes sure that our system is declarative, right? So what's in the DOM over here? It's the clickable behavior, which adds the event listener. It's configurable, and then has a signal transport which has some metadata to talk to the server. And then it also has the stop propagation thing, which will stop events from bubbling. There are other behaviors. There's like has state, which is like which is a generic thing to get any property on any X event. And then key press behavior, which I'm using in the REPL to watch for control enter and stuff. And then finally, there's this thing called interpreters, which addresses the concerns that exist between getting the message from the browser and converting it into a Julia value, right? So over there, as you saw, the clicks were becoming an actual Julia type, saying which mouse button it is. So all that is handled by interpreters. Okay, I think this is too much talking for now. So I'm just going to show some simple demos for a while, and then I'll switch back and finish my presentation. So this is Minesweeper in Escher. Any guesses how many lines of code this is? There's actually supposed to be icons in those. The assets are not loading for some reason. Any guesses how many lines of code? 50. Yes. Huh? 15. Oh. Where? Oh. That's a little too optimistic, I think. Let's see. No, it's actually like 70 lines. I shouldn't show you that. Yeah, 89 with a lot of white spaces and comments. So it's a simple app. So the way you write these apps is you make your own model to describe the scene, right? The entire app. So in this case, the board describes the entire app. So I'm just going to go through these things. So this is an immutable type in Julia. That's how you create it. So that's the name of the type is board, and it has a parameter called lost, which is a Boolean value, true or false. Like you can have parameters which are actually values in Julia, like two types. And then there is a matrix. Which has like the list of uncovered tiles and how many mines are around them. And then there is a matrix which contains like a Boolean. It's a Boolean matrix of mines, basically. And then, so I have this function, all important function called next, which is going to progress my board from one state to another, given the move, right? Like, so it's taking the board, and then a move, and then returning me a new board. So in the first case, the board is actually dead because the parameter here is true, right? Like it means that you have already lost the game. So if you have any moves, then you just return the board back. In the next case, it's more complicated. You have the board and the move, and then what you do is you create a new board where you count the mines around the thing that you clicked on, and then return that. Oh, okay. I'm pressing all the wrong keys. Okay, so that's the main logic of the program. So now what you need is to convert this board type into a UI, right? You do that by defining a function again. So I have this function called showBoard, which takes the board and then creates an Escher UI, which denotes the board. And it's again built with like smaller parts, which are things like the things like this block over here. Block will just like add an event, subscribe any updates to that block to the move signal. And then at the end, I'm just like saying consume show board with the board signal. The board signal updates automatically when I do things in the UI, right? Okay, so let's go back to another example over here is okay, while that loads. Okay, so interpreters. Maybe we'll just wait for this. That's again using the same logic, right? Like it's taking an FBS value and then doing this. I think I'm like way out of time. So interpreters. So you can attach like different kind of interpretations to widgets on the screen. For example, I'm attaching a constant interpreter to this button, which has plus, and then a minus one to this thing, and then writing that to delta signal. Right? So this is again an alias for the subscribe operator. And then bold L is going to consume the delta and then keep adding it. And you get a counter. Okay, yeah, finally, thanks to Elm, Virtual DOM, Polymer, and Katek for all the JavaScript. And the, yeah, Evan's thesis is very nice about Elm. Thanks to these people from the Julia community. Daniel Jones, who wrote Compose and Guidefly. Zach Alon, who wrote Functional Collections. And Tim Holy, who wrote Images. I didn't actually show any image for us. But yeah, it's usable with Escher and then SymPy. Yeah, thanks. I'll end it. Any questions? Can be addressed. No, it's a JSON, whatever.
So my question is more like, so the JSON from the browser goes all the way to the Julia server, and that gets converted to a Julia type. Mm-hmm. Then you have the functional code, which actually processes
yes.
it as a normal function, returns their value, and then that gets converted to JSON and comes back to the browser for rendering.
Right.
So. Essentially, there is absolutely no client processing at all.
I mean, there is, like, for example.
I mean, can I, is no. it, what I'm asking is, can I write completely client-side JavaScript?
Yeah, you can. You will have to put that in a web component.
Okay.
Like, define a clear declarative API on top of it. Yeah, like, you can write.
Do you have time for one more question?
Yes, sir.
Sure.
Yeah, go ahead.
Myself is Adarsh, and I saw that. I mean, this is pretty impressive.
Thanks.
So you are replacing that V-box kind of stuff, abstracts and all, just with hundreds of thousands of lines of CSS.
Right.
So have you gone through the CSS 3?
I mean, yeah, like Flexbox is part of CSS 3.
Yeah. So
that's what I'm using, actually.
Okay. So if anybody would like to go for CSS 3 or your Julia,
right.
what do you prefer though?
You can use all the so the point of abstracting the DOM is that like basically CSS 3 ultimately is a property in the DOM element, right? Like style dot fill color or I mean style dot background color, like style dot flex. So that's actually just like a DOM property. So you can generate, you can basically write functions which will implement those CSS features for you. I mean, which will cover those CSS features for you in Escher. Right.
Yeah.
Like, you don't really need to use the functions defined inside Escher. Keep adding things to it.
Yeah, this is something like consolidating the CSS3 functionalities and then giving you a easy to use kinds of tools or libraries. You reach out to the solutions pretty quickly than CSS3. I can agree that.
Yeah. I think like the whole point is like if you want to write a template, for example, you don't need to create like a bunch of classes. Or stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
You just create a function. We can talk later.
Fine.